Welcome to my Java video series. Today I'm going to talk about JDBC, its Java database connectivity. And this is nothing but your JDBC API. So this JDBC API is present in java.sql package. And one more package we have here, javax.sql. These two are the packages, and this is your one of the old package, and this is your extension package. So these two packages contains most of the features which is related to the JDBC. So before talking about the JDBC connectivity, I will start from understanding of client server architecture for database. So this is database client server architecture. The understanding of database client server architecture is very important before connecting database from the Java application. So I'm going to use MySQL for this course because it is very simple database, lightweight database, and it is a popular database. It will not take too much time to configure and install. So let's begin from the database architecture. So in the terms of MySQL I'm talking here. So you will see here one database server. This is, suppose this is your database server. So this is your server. You need to install the server first. So I call it database server. And in the terms of MySQL, when you install this database server, you will see a process named MySQL D. D stands for, it's a daemon process. So MySQL D is a process name. It's a process name for, this is a process name for server. So this is MySQL D. And a database server contains multiple schemas, or you can call it multiple databases. So this is your database server. It can have multiple schema. So suppose your, this is first schema, I call it database one. For example, this is schema one or database one, schema one. So you can name your database or you can name your schema, and inside this database schema you can have multiple database objects. So database contains database objects. So what will be the database objects? You can have different database objects here. For example, you can have tables. Tables are database objects. So you can have tables, you can have views, you can have indices, you can have cursor, you can have procedure, you can have functions, you can have sequence, you can have trigger, etc. So these are the different database objects available. So a database schema or a database contains these many things, and we can have multiple schemas or multiple databases supported. So these are the different schemas. For example, this is your database 2, and I can call it schema 2, or I can call it, this is database 3, database n. So you can have multiple databases here. So now this is how you can see the database server with multiple databases. Now we can have a client here which can communicate to the server. So suppose this is my client, and this is the standard command line client. This is called MySQL command line client. So this is your command line interface, CLI supported. This is command line interface supported client. So every database company comes with the command line client supported. So this is your MySQL server, and it comes with the MySQL client. So when you install MySQL in your system, you will get the server as well as this command line client installed. Now you can connect to the database from this command line. So this is how you can see. So this is your client and this is your server. Similarly, you can have different clients here. For example, if you are if you want some graphical tool or database modeling tool, there is one MySQL Workbench, it's a very good tool. So this MySQL Workbench is your client. So this is another useful tool I recommend to use for advanced practices. When we work in projects, we'll follow the Workbench tool. So this is very good tool, but if you are a beginner, we strongly recommend you to understand the query and do access your database with the help of queries. Now we can have some different clients here. For example, I'm going to write a Java application. So actually my topic is this JDBC, so my Java application can be your client. So this Java application as client, so the program I'm going to write through the JDBC will be your client connecting to the database. And there are some other clients available here. For example, if you have suppose .NET application or PHP application, so these can be a client. So because you can access the system through, you can access the database server through these techniques. So your Java application or your .NET application or your other application can be your client. So this is how we can see. Now let's move on to the another client. I have seen one popular client in this industry. So when you access your database from the internet or from the hosting panel, you will see one database client inbuilt there, that is called PHP MyAdmin. This is another web-based client available to access to administrate your database from the web panel. So this is your web client. So a web client is also supported here, and this is very much popular for the hosting industry. So this is also available to access your database. Now you can have one project based on Java, and this same data can be accessed from the different modules in the same project. Suppose you have a big project, few modules are designed in Java, few modules are designed in PHP, and some of the module is designed through the .NET. All these different technologies can use common data. So how it is possible? Because database server is common, and this database server can be accessed from any platform, any technology, and this is possible through the SQL. There is one common standard available here. This is a common interface to access any database. To communicate with any database, you need to talk in SQL language. So if you talk to database in terms of SQL, it can answer. So this is your SQL. SQL is a common standard to communicate to the database. Means when this command line client is communicating to the database, you need to use SQL. When you are communicating database from Java application, you required SQL. Or when you are communicating through the PHP application, you required SQL. So SQL is a common standard you need to use to communicate to the database server. So we call it, it's a SQL is a common interface to communicate to client, to communicate to the server. So if you are planning to communicate to database server, you need to speak SQL as standard language. So this is how we can see the client server architecture. So let me talk about the tool name which is used for this MySQL standard client. This tool is in terms of Microsoft operating system, you will see here MySQL.exe. This tool is called MySQL.exe, and this tool will be your MySQL d.exe. So these are the tools you will see, and there can be some other advanced tools you will see in market. They are open source tools available, so they have some specific advanced provisions like modeling your database server, administration of the database server, and normal query browsing. So I personally recommend you to use MySQL Workbench, because this MySQL Workbench is a standard tool, and there are two variants available here. So I personally advise you to use MySQL Workbench as your database administrator, database admin. It's a client tool basically. So there are two variants available here. So one is Enterprise Edition. Enterprise Edition, it is a commercial tool, and another is Community Edition. So this is your open source, this is your free, and the first one is a commercial tool. You need to buy the license here. It's a commercial tool, so you need to purchase the license for this. Similarly, MySQL Server itself comes in two different flavors. So suppose if we are talking about MySQL Server, MySQL database server, see, this is different than your MS SQL Server. MS SQL Server is a different server which is provided by Microsoft, but MySQL Server is a different server. This is handled by the Oracle Corporation itself. Now it has two different variants. MySQL Server has two different variants. It has one Community Edition and Enterprise Edition. So for advanced need, you can go for the Enterprise Server, and for general purpose you can go with the MySQL Community Edition. So these two different variants are available. So when you are working with the MySQL workbench, you can do here three major things. First, you can use here database modeling. So it has support for reverse engineering, forward engineering, and on and all. And another is database browsing, or you can call it this is explorer. This is database explorer. You can check your tables, you can check the databases, you can check the data inside the tables and all. So all database explorer exploring options you will see inside this module. And it has one more module called database administration. So this is your third module inside the workbench, database administration or management. So database administration will allow you to create new users inside the database, to set permission for the user, grant, revoke, all these options related to the database management will be there. So let me summarize quickly. You can create user, you can create here, and you can role permissions you can handle here. Then you can manage the backup and restore options you will see, etc. So these are the options you will see from the database administrative module. So this is how we can see. So I personally advise you to go through the MySQL workbench, and to start with we will go through the Community Edition. So this is open source. Now let's begin with the set of tools we required here. So first, I have already downloaded these tools in my system. So let me show you where I kept these. So go to the software, and here you will see a different software tools. I have MySQL database software. This is my folder. See here, I have downloaded all these software, and they are non-installation version. Means you just have to unzip these packages and use it without any installation. So I personally prefer to use non-installation version because this is quite easy to configure without any additional efforts. So I have here this workbench 64-bit, and you can also use this workbench Community Edition for 32-bit. And this is your server. So this is your server. This is your MySQL server. I'm using 5.6.33, and I'm using for 64-bit, and I'm using this workbench. So these two different tools I'm going to use here. So now let me show you these tools I have unzipped under this E drive. So let me take you to the E drive. Go to the E drive and program files, and I have these tools unzipped here. So look at this. This is your workbench I have unzipped here, and this is your database server we have. So I have not installed these things. I just copy paste and unzipped here. That's it, nothing else, no installation required. But the most important thing you need to remember here, to run these two different tools, you need a Microsoft client runtime required here. So let me show you where I can see the Microsoft runtime is required in your computer to run these things. So let me show you where I can found these. So these are the different clients required. So you need to configure these many things here. So these are the MySQL runtimes available in my computer. These are the Visual Studio runtime clients available in my computer for 64-bit, 32-bit, and different versions you can see here. So it depends on the requirement what version your software have been using. They while using, they will prompt you for the right version you need. So most probably you can take this distribution C++, Microsoft Visual C++ for 2013 for 64-bit, or you can check the things. So these are the Microsoft runtime tools you required in your system to run your database server. Once it is all set, now you need to start a database server. Without starting the database server, we cannot work. So this is my client. So client will be the secondary part. First you need to set up the database. So if database server is running, then client will be connecting to the server. So installing workbench is not just enough. So workbench is just a client. Without workbench, without database server, workbench is nothing. So you go to the MySQL 5.6. this is, I have unzipped under this program files in C drive, and I'm using all 64-bit configuration because my system is 64-bit. Here in this area you will see one important thing. This is bin folder, and inside the bin you will see here different clients. So let me talk about some important things here, important tools here. So this is your MySQL, this is your MySQL command line client, and you can go downside, and you will see here this is your MySQL, this is your MySQL D, this is your database server. And here you will see some important tools like MySQL import tool, MySQL show tool, and MySQL dump is very important to take a backup. This is a backup tool, MySQL dump, and other MySQL admin you will see in the list. I'm not able to see, go to the up. This is MySQL administrative tool. So like this, you will have different tools here. You have different tools available here to work on the projects. And one more thing, go to this directory, you will see one data directory. So all data, all database related files you will see under this data. So this is an inbuilt directory available here. So whatever the database you will create there inside your server, you will get here folder configured. So these are some internal folders available. Now I'm going to talk about the database server. Open this database server. So do you have running, is this running in your computer right now? So I have to check first, is that running here? Check this, go to the task manager. Oh, it is already running in my computer. Probably I started today. So let me untask this, let me close this, I finish this. Now I need to start the database server here. So this is MySQL D, and where it is located? C drive, program files, MySQL, and this bin. So inside this you will see this server. So this is running. So when you double click here, or you can click and check this run as admin, so this will start your server. So when your server is started, you can check the processes here. Look at this, you can go to the process category, and this is your MySQL server running. Now once your server is running, you can connect to the server through the client. So I'm using this MySQL client, just a minute. Look at this, it has connected the client here. And one more thing, I would prefer to connect through the command prompt. So let me open terminal here. This is your command prompt, this is your command prompt, and I can connect to the server using this MySQL U stands for user, and type the name of this user. This is root, and this is P stands for password. So initially, first time when you unzip your database installation there, the default password will be empty. It will not ask you for the password. You just have to pass the username and just like this, just enter this. So this will work first time when you configure, but actually I have changed the password in my computer. That's why it is creating a problem here. Access denied, because I set the password for root user, but in your system first time when you set up the database, it will not ask you for the password and it will directly take you to the MySQL prompt. So initially when system is set up, no password is configured, so empty password is there. Without password you can connect to the server, but I have changed the password and my password is MySQL. See this? Now I'm connected to the server and it has taken me to the MySQL prompt. Now let me write here few commands. So I have few commands here. So this is MySQL, sorry, so databases. This will list all the databases running here, running inside this server. So check this, I have 6 databases running here. So this is an internal database, this is an internal database, this is an internal database, this is also internal databases. I created 2 databases in my system, so these 2 are created by me, and now I'm going to create one more database here. So I'm going to create one more database here using this command, create database. So this will actually create a database schema, and I'm going to create a database here, create database. Database name I can use here, test underscore db is my database. So this is my database and semicolon. It has created one database. Now check that list, look at this, this is another database created by me. So earlier there was 6 databases, 6 schemas are there, and now you have 7 schemas. Now you created this database, but right now there is no tables available inside this database. So I need to select this database, test db, select the database here, and now when the database is selected, now you can create here, create table, and I'm going to create table inside my schema, inside my database, create table employee, and employee ID, and this will be integer, and this will be primary key column, and I'm going to make it auto increment. So this will be the value for the employee ID will be automatically generated here, and the second column is name, this is worker, and I can put the size here, for 50 is a size. Name column will be of size 50. Now the next column will be salary, and I'm going to make it float. Just a minute, let me arrange the screen. This is your float, and this is float, and let's change the size here, float. The size will be, salary will be 14 characters, the total size will be 14, and 3 digits will be used after decimal point. So integer part will be 11 character, and 3 characters will be after decimal point, so total will be 14. So this is how I can create. Now put a semicolon at the end and enter. So look at this, a table is created. Now I can show here list of tables inside my database. So show tables. So you will get here one table. I created this table recently from this command, create table. I created this. Now let me insert some data. Insert some data, insert into employee, and I'm going to insert data on name of the employee and salary of the employee. It is a very good practice to define set of columns here while insertion. So this is a good practice, it must be like this only. So this is value, and I'm going to insert some data here. So numeric sequence of characters or string will be written in the form of single quote in database terms. So I'm going to insert a date record here, Vikram Thakur. So this is my name, and I'm going to put my salary here. This is my salary, and this is I'm going to use here my salary. Yeah, this is my salary, and insert this. So a record will be created here. I'm going to create one more record here. This is Vikram Thakur. I'm going to call here. This is my friend. This is Nitin. This is another user I'm going to create, and I'm going to put some salary here. Insert this. So two records I created here. Now this is third record, and done. Now I created here three records. I inserted three records. Check here, FROM. Check all records from this employee table. So this is how you can see all records. I recently entered three records, and you can see here. And there are some other queries you can perform inside the database server. For example, when you write here star means all columns. So I can select here a specific column, like employee ID. I'm going to use employee ID and name. When you put the columns here, you will get only two columns and all record. Star stands for all columns, but we always advise you to provide the set of columns you want to fetch from the server. So it is wonderful practice. So we avoid to use a star because it will always access all the all columns. So probably you may not require all the columns. But one more thing you can see here, the value for this ID, value for this employee ID is internally generated by the server itself. So this is actually done through the auto increment setting. So this is how we can see some more database queries you can perform here. For example, you can write here where clause, where employee ID equals to, for example, one. You will see only one employee. Where employee ID, where employee ID, you can use some in query. Where employee ID in, I want 1, 3. You will get only 1 and 3. I made a mistake here. Okay, where employee ID in this one. So this is how you can see only 1 and 3, because you mentioned here this one. Similarly, there are different options available here, not in. So skip 1 and 3, and 2 will be available. So this is how you can see different queries. Similarly, there are provision to add some pattern queries, like where you can use here where name starts with suppose I want name starts with N, and after that there can be any character. Okay, just a minute. Where name, like, what is missing here? I missed here. Okay, just a minute. I need to use only one column here. Where name, like, N. So look at this. Where name starts with N, you will get here these two names, Nitin and Nilesh. These two names starts with N. So if you want some different pattern, you can use here. Suppose I'm using here the employee name must contain I. So no matter it is present, I is present at the beginning or end or in the middle. So you can get here all names. This is I, this name contains I, this name contains I, this name contains N. So this is how you can see. So these are some pattern queries. Some other patterns are also available. For example, the first character can be anything. So this underscore is representing any character but single character, and percentage represents any character and n characters. Means there can be one character, two character, five character, but underscore represents any character but single character. So you can see here first name can be anything, and second name must be I, and after that there can be any characters. So look at this, all characters, first character can be anything but second character is I. This is fixed. And after that, there can be any characters. So let me change this pattern here a little bit. So I want what should be the pattern I can use here? First character must be, I'm going to use here, first character should be N, second character should be I, and third character can be n. Just a minute. First character must be n, second character should be I, and third character, just a minute, second character can be anything, or third character will be K, right? And after that there can be any characters. Now look at this, not K, this is L. So you will see here only Nilesh. Why? Because the first character is N, you will see here. Second character can be anything, so, but the third character must be L. So third character must be L. After that there can be any characters. So this is how you can make the pattern. So underscore means one character, but it can be any characters. So these are some pattern queries. Similarly, there are provision to use here some functions, like I can use here some function like I'm going to calculate sum for all salary. So these are some SQL functions you can use. You can calculate here max salary, you can find the max salary like this. This is max salary. You can find some min salary. So there are different options available in SQL. This is min salary. Similarly, you can count here average. This is average salary. So these are the things you can see. You can count number of records here. So you can count here how many records are there in my table. Count star from employee. So how many records are there? You can see 3 records in my table, something like this. So there are different options available here. And one more thing, one more important query I use many time to select one. This is very important. So I use this query to check the database response, whether database is responding or it is not responding. So sometime I use this particular query to validate the connection. So when I open the connection from my Java application, I will validate the connection, whether it is working. If it is returning one, means connection is working. So this is sometime useful. So we'll talk more about the queries. You can refer my notes and check all different kind of queries from the for the MySQL supported MySQL database. So this is enough for the first session on the database. In next series we'll talk about how to communicate database server from Java application. So thank you very much for watching.